Any questions on this one? Yeah? Makes sense, right? 250. You include a range that you provided, the cost of the range, and make sure, don't forget the to include the shipping cost of that range. If you decide to provide the textile machinery at your own cost, then you include the cost of the textile machinery to produce textiles. Of course, that's only good if you do that, right? If this was at the initiative of the foreign assembler, then you would not include it in the price. Now we get to rebates. So let's look at the definition of the rebate. Rebate is an amount paid by way of reduction or refund on keyword what has been already paid. So I think mail-in rebate is or the instant rebate is not so much is much more tricky, because what happens in a manufacturer instant rebate is really it's constructive, but you pay them money, then they pay you back the rebate, and they charge you tax on the whole thing. It just takes instantly. So the whole transaction takes place instantaneously, right? Here, you give cash back, or you give money back, or you give refund after something has been paid. So in this situation, notice the rebate takes place after the price. Notice that this is different from the discount. The discount has been agreed upon before, and you took the discount before. So in other words, you gave the discount. You paid the money which are already discounted. In the case of rebate, you pay the full amount, and then you get the discount. And this timing is critical, because for customs purposes, you don't take the rebate into the account. You don't declare $80, but you declare $100. It's the timing that you need to keep in mind. Foreign inland freight. So remember my example with Shanghai and Tibet, which I talked about in the beginning of the class. Now, here you have to go back all the way to the beginning of our class conversation, early on in the summer, and recall various international commercial terms. For those of you who have books, I believe it's in chapter 2 of the material, and one of the commercial terms is called X factory, which means the buyer and the seller agree that the buyer or the importer will be pretty much responsible for the whole thing. He will make arrangements for everything. Notice, in that case, all the manufacturer or the seller has to do is make the product available. That's why it's called X factory. It's like right outside of the factory. So you make something, you just place it out on the dock, and you just fulfill your duty. Whereas in the case of FOB, your duty, if you are located, let's say, in Tibet, would be, you know, if it's FOB Shanghai, your responsibility would be placed on the dock, put it on a truck, ship it to Shanghai, and once it passed the rail of the ship, or once it passed the tarmac of the airplane, then your duty will be fulfilled. Are you gonna include, are you gonna sell it at a higher price if the terms are FOB than at factory, if you are the manufacturer? Probably yes, because you not only charging for the production of the product, you also charging for all those incidental charges which will take as you deliver the product to Shanghai, in using the hypothetical I talked about. So next factor, if the price, transaction value, actually paid or payable, does not include this, then those charges will not be added to the price. What does it mean? That means that you are paying duty on foreign inland freight. This will be the only time where you will be, you have a foreign inland freight which is dutiable. If it's FOB, it's already incorporated. If it's CIF, it's already incorporated. But here you have X factory, and it's not included. I think I have a picture here of the responsibilities. Notice, those are the responsibilities where they end from the manufacturer. The rest is the responsibility of the importer or the buyer. What about other ones? Sorry, folks, I'll take that back. They will not be added to the price. That means they will not be dutiable. Everyone follows? Because you only pay duty on the price actually paid or payable under the transaction value, the most common, commonly tested. If they will not be added to the price, they will not be dutiable. I take that back. I was thinking forward to the next example where foreign, in a situation where foreign inland freight is dutiable. So if it is not X factory, if it is anything else where the exporter takes assumes more responsibility, then price of actually paid or payable will include charges for the foreign inland freight. So, and this we have seen, the CIF, it already by its definition includes foreign inland freight. It can be something in the like shipment in town, let's say from one part of Shanghai to the dock, which is quite expensive too. What's the rate? Latest rate I got for the shipment, small container shipment was like $200-$250 from one part of the Shanghai to another. So it can be quite a bit. It can add up. So what happens in a situation if your foreign inland freight is broken out as a separate line item? There is a possibility for you to avoid paying duties for the foreign inland freight. And why is that? Because recall, going back to the X factory, if you break it out, you don't have to pay duties for the foreign inland freight. But if you have other terms, you have to pay duties. So there is a special carve-out rule which must meet these three criteria. Charges must be broken out separately, separate line item. Charges must take place after the merchandise has been sold. So you have a contract, January 1, and then you go to the shipping company and you make sure you make a separate agreement after the contract of January 1, let's say January 9th. And this is a magic word, through bill of lading. So through bill of lading. So what you will have is you have bill of lading, which states the point of origin and a point of destination. So on the through bill of lading will say instead of Shanghai, New York, it will say some point in Tibet, New York. That's the key. If you have all those three, you can take out FOB charges. And the reason you will be able to, because they are broken out. Just like you can take the international shipping charges, let's say the marine charges or the air charges. You can do that for the foreign inland freight too. Next one, packing costs. So packaging, plastic wraps, boxes. They're part. Unless they are instruments of international traffic. So you pay workers to put the things in a box. You pay for the box, you pay for the labor, but you don't pay for the outermost container, because that outermost container will most likely be leased by you anyway, but it can be purchased by you. But if the outermost container, the international shipping container, is used, it is regarded as an instrument of international traffic. And it will not be part of the merchant. It will not be part of the value that you declare to customs. It will not be part of the value which you pay for because of that designation. Instrument of international traffic. Usually, most of the time, it will be international shipping container. It can be other things such as bins, such as heavy-duty container, like heavy-duty boxes. But usually they are not tested in that context on the custom exam. What's the customs favorite to test you on containers in a customs broker examination? GRI 5. GRI 5, remember? Anyone? Yeah. So if I bring in methane in those gas holding containers, those metal ones, would those am I declaring with them as part of the value, or I'm only declaring the value of the methane? Or think about if you go to the gas station or wherever, you see there is a propane tanks. Let's say you bring a propane tank through customs. Are you declaring value for the propane, or are you declaring value for the propane and the tank? GRI 5 will tell you the answer. And the answer will be most likely under GRI 5B, because it is normally, the propane is normally delivered in those tanks, although they are heavy duty and they are quite expensive. It is not part. It is not separate line item. It is not separately broken down. Do you have to pay duty? Well, it depends whether it's instrument of international traffic or not. Okay, let's move on. So packing costs are dutiable. What about selling commission versus buying commission? So I hire someone, and this is practical in the case of Hong Kong versus mainland China scenario, where you, in Hong Kong you have a lot of representative offices that are known as vendors that sell things to the West and have special relationship with the mainland factories. That's changing, but throughout the 1990s and 2000s to the early 2000s, that was the framework. And who are those vendors in Hong Kong? They are mostly the selling agents. They represent the mainland China. And they charge commission, they're not doing it for free. So when you have a transaction where, let's say, shipments ship directly from factory in mainland China to, let's say, New York, and the Hong Kong charges a fee, let's say 5%, do you include that 5% on the dutiable value? Or you kind of make a separate invoice? Yes, you do. Yes, you do. Unlike buying commission, where I hire, let's say, someone here to find me a vendor outside of the United States, the selling commission, the selling agent. The agent who represents the other party outside of the United States. If they charge a commission, that's part of the dutiable value. Everyone sees the difference between buying agents and selling agents? Anyone rented an apartment here in New York through an agency? What's the first question you ask? You ask, are you a buying agent or the selling agent? Because if they say you are the buying agent, most likely you hang up because they're going to charge you a fee. If they say, no, I'm a selling agent, that means you never see the fee. It's between them and the landlord. Here, you have to see the fee because you have to include that on the invoice. Selling commissions are dutiable. Remember that rule. All right. So we talked about assets. When I talked about assets, I talked about mold. The value of assets includes the transportation costs. Remember the range, right? That would be an asset. So but assets is a label. It's a term of art, which is made up of all those stuff. Supply directly or indirectly? What's indirectly? Indirectly means I pick up the phone and I call Indonesia and the guy in Indonesia supplies that range to the guy in China without ever hitting United States. But I'm the puppet master here. I'm the one who's pulling all the strings, making the arrangement, sitting here in New York. That would be example of indirect. Directly, I go to Home Depot, I buy a range, I put it in a UPS pack and ship it over. That would be example of direct assistance. Free of charge or reduced cost. I am not charging that guy for the range, but he's taking benefit of the tool. So on my end, I need to pay include that in the duty. And of course, that range must be used in connection with the production or export. So if I let's say I have a European market and a United States market, and I gave the guy a range, I say, use it for European shipments only. For the United States, use hands. Because we can use the label, let's say, handmade, right? Because it's apparently has a higher quality, right? Handmade, screwed nuts and bolts. So we can charge extra. Okay, that can do. So that way you do not use, you do not charge for the range. So products of service, I think here